Amen. Amen. Well, this morning we are back to our series. We've been kind of jumping around with some different things, but we're back to our series entitled Kingdom Values, where we've been talking about, you know, what are the kingdom values that God has? When you think about the king and his kingdom, what's he value most? What are those things? And we've been talking about that value. We all place value on certain things. Now, how is it that we place value on things? Well, number one, we place value on things based on our need. If I need something, if I need, you know, this or that in my life, it's a true need, I place a higher value on those things. Man, I tell you what, and it changes from time to time, right? Think about, you know, just 3 years ago, during COVID, one of the most valued items was what? Toilet paper. Right? Who in the world's going to value toilet paper? But toilet paper had this incredible value because of this perceived need that we were going to have in our lives. So number one, value is determined by need. Number two is determined by desire. Right? What do I desire in life? What do I want? What really burns in my heart? You know, if I really want to put my feet in the sand on the beach, I value that time above other things in my life. Why? So that I can direct resources, direct my life in that direction. But here's the third one, emotions. That our emotions work in our lives to determine value, our feelings. You know, it's interesting, you know, Rick Carter, who's been here two or three times to speak with us, his grandson Chase, you know, was with him quite a bit, and in their garage a while back was this lawnmower. Old junky lawnmower. Now this lawnmower didn't run. Rick would mess with it and it would run for a couple minutes and then it would die, and they'd work on it some more and it'd run a little while and then it'd die. And so it pretty much just sat in the corner of the garage. Well, Rick said, I decided one day, I told Chase, my grandson, I said, you can have that tractor. Well, he was elated. Right? That's my tractor. Now it sat in the corner of the garage, never went anywhere. He would go out and sit on it. But then one day, a couple years ago, a guy comes over to Rick's house and he's doing something else and he notices in the garage this old junky lawnmower sitting back in the corner that's just taking up space and collecting dust. Maybe $150. I see this face up here. It's like, $150? Heck yeah, I'll take that. Or, sure, I'll take that. And so he takes the $150 for this lawnmower to get it out of his garage, fully intending to give that $150 to his grandson. But when his grandson comes over and notices that the lawnmower's not in the garage anymore, he's devastated. Where's my lawnmower? Where's my tractor? Rick said, well, I got $150. Here, I'll give you the $150. I don't want the $150. I want my lawnmower. What was going on? Chase had an emotional attachment, and he placed great value on that old junky thing because of emotion. It was more important to him. And I suspect we all do that. We all have certain things in our life that we find important. Sometimes it falls under tradition or certain things in our life. And the reality is that we have those things that we place a higher value on. I tell you what, in our house, there is a large corner cupboard that came out of my grandparents from the farm, you know, long, long time ago. It sits in the corner, and it's huge, and it's full of stuff that you would look at and say there is absolutely no value to those things, and yet they have a place of honor in our home because of the emotional, traditional family connections that they have. Emotion has a big part to play in what we value. And the question we've been asking in this series is, so what are those things that God values more than anything else? Well, the first one we talked about a while back was love. That love is first and foremost, he values us loving him and him loving us. We talked about family, that he values family. It's through family that he does all that he wants to do to fill the earth. But here's the third one this morning, and that's presence. God loves. God gets excited. God always desires to be, for you and I to be in his presence. Now, when you think about that in the natural, isn't that true? That in the natural, don't we desire to be in the presence of those that we love? You know, as husbands and, you know, husbands and wives, as parents, as grandparents and great-grandparents, what's our desire? We want to be with them where they are or where we are. We want their presence with us. You know, Brenda talks about Wesley all the time, and, you know, she gets to FaceTime him and talk to him on the phone, and, you know, he's starting to talk enough to call her Grammy, and, you know, and but the reality is the other night they were sitting in the chair, she's FaceTiming, and hung up, she goes, it's not going to be that long till I get to be with him. As great as FaceTime was, a longing to be in his presence. It's true of Brenda and I. Brenda loves being in the same room with me. As husband and wife, she wants to be in the same room. We're not even doing anything. We're just sitting, she's sitting in her chair, I'm sitting in my chair, and we're not even talking. We're doing stuff, we're reading stuff, we're doing stuff. But she's like, I need your presence in the room. And that is how we are in the natural. But I want you to understand, God places great value on being with those that he loves. And I want to suggest from the very beginning of this book to the very end, God screams from heaven over and over and over his desire for us to be in his presence. Genesis chapter 2, verse 4 says this, then this is the account of the heavens and the earth when they were created in the day of the Lord. God made the earth and the heavens. And so God makes what? He makes all the heavens and the earth. But verse 7 says, then the Lord formed man out of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils and the breath of life, and man became a living person. In Genesis chapter 1, you know, God says what? Let us make man in our own image, in our likeness. So what's God do? He creates the heavens and the earth, he creates the planet, creates everything on it. And then what's he do? On the sixth day, he creates Adam in the image of what? The Father, the Son, and the Spirit. In our image, he created him. He breathed life into him. And then what happened? Well, let me ask this first. Why did God create a race of beings that were created in his image? Why'd you do that? Well, let me ask you a question. Why do people have children? Now, I'm not talking about the physical nature of that, all right? Why do parents choose to have, some of you are like, wow, I'm thinking about that right now. Why did you choose to have kids? Why? Why did you choose to have one child or two children or a whole house full? Why do people choose that? Well, maybe it's because we want to fulfill the Great Commission of we want to fill the earth with the glory of the Lord, right? And so we're just going to have one kid at a time to build the kingdom. You know, maybe we're thinking about that. Maybe we're thinking about being fruitful and multiplying and filling the earth. But I suspect for most, that's not the reason. The reason is, the reason we choose to have children is because when we look at them, they are a what? Representation of us. They are a fruit of our lives that's going to carry on from generation to generation to generation, that we're propagating their families. How come so many parents and grandparents say stuff like call their grandkids their mini-me's or their littles? Because they see themselves in those little ones, in their kids, in their grandkids, in their great-grandkids. See, I want you to understand, God created Adam and Eve. He created the human race because, number one, he was expanding his kingdom. He was establishing a family. But I want you to notice what else he was doing. Back in Genesis 2:8, it says this, and the Lord planted a garden towards the east in Eden, and there he placed the man whom he had formed. Out of the ground, the Lord God caused every tree to grow, and that is pleasing sight for food. Life was also in the midst of the garden and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. I want to suggest that not only did he create Adam and Eve, he created a place for them. Watch what he did. Verse 15 says, then the Lord took the man and put him in the garden of Eden and to cultivate it and tend it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, from any tree of the garden you may eat freely, but from the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For on that day you will eat from it, you will surely die. See, God created Adam and Eve, and then Adam, and then he gave him a place to live, a place to work, a place to be productive, a place to fulfill, live out life. And then look what it says in verse 18. Then the Lord said, it's not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. And then what? He takes out a rib and he makes Eve and he brings Eve to Adam. And together he had places Adam and Eve in the garden. He created a life for Adam. He created Eve out of Adam. He brought Eve to Adam. Creation was complete. Two C's there. All right. Creation was complete. But what was God's ultimate purpose in creating a specific place for Adam and Eve to dwell? Well, what happened? Here they were living in the garden, and then the serpent showed up, and you guys know what happened there. They ate from the fruit of the tree. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 8 says, after all that happened, what happened? Now they heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day. Now that's a fascinating picture. What do you think about that? Adam and Eve are in the garden. They've eaten from the fruit. And they hear God walking in the garden. How did they know it was God? How did they know it wasn't an elephant? How did they know it wasn't a tiger or a lion or some? Because let me tell you why. Because it was normal operating procedure for God to walk in the garden and meet with them and walk with them and talk with them and spend time with them, that they would be in his presence. The garden was a place God created for them to be together. He wanted to spend time with Adam and Eve. But I want you to notice what goes on. And the man said to his wife, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God. So here they hear God, and what happens? Now it says they hide themselves from his presence among the trees. And then the Lord called to the man and said, where are you? Adam, where are you? Why would God say that? Because here's what happened. I suspect multiple times a day, God shows up in the garden. He's walking in the garden. Adam and Eve hear him, and what do? They run to him. Every single time, they run to be in his presence. And then what happens? This time, God's walking in the garden. He's like, Adam, where are you, man? How come you guys don't come running? See, God created the earth a place. He created sons and daughters so that they would dwell in his presence. See, I want you to understand, you and I were first and foremost created to be in his presence. Steve, first and foremost, you were created. He gave you life as a son to be in his presence. Sheila, first and foremost, he created you so that you would be in his presence. That's been his desire from the very, very beginning. The first 10 says this, Adam said, I heard you, the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and so I hid myself. You got to understand, it's sin and shame that causes us to hide from God's presence, not God to hide from us. Well, you got to get that. We're the ones who hide from his presence. He's not the one hiding from us. He's not the one not desiring to be with us. It's sin and shame that keeps us away. It's sin and shame that draws us away. Verse 11 says, and he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree for which I've commanded you not to eat? Well, and then, you know, then what happens? They start blaming one another, right? Well, it was that woman you gave me, and she made me eat, and then I ate, and you know, this whole rigmarole goes on. And then we find, in those next verses, we find the curses that are. Verse 22. Then the Lord God said, behold, the man has become like us, knowing good and evil. And now he might reach out his hand and take from the fruit from the tree and eat and live forever. Therefore, the Lord God sent him out of the garden of Eden to cultivate the ground. Now, here's the question. Why were Adam and Eve no longer allowed to go to the garden? I guarantee you, many of us were taught because they no longer can be in God's presence. Sin has separated them from God's presence. But that's not what the text says. Why did they get removed? Because of sin, they had to die, and the tree of life was in the garden. And God says we can't let them eat from the tree of life anymore, that they would live eternally, because now sin has brought death. Nowhere in that text does it ever say God didn't want to hang out with them anymore. Oh, come on now. I know what you've been taught. I was taught the same thing. God can't hang out with a dirty sinner like you. He can't look on someone like you. That's not in the text. That's not the book. Because I want you to notice, this: God never stopped wanting us to be in his presence. No matter what's happened in our life, he never stopped wanting us to be in our presence. Well, I was really messing up. He still wanted you to be in his presence. You were still his son or daughter. Now, don't get me wrong. Sin limits our access to God. But he still desires to be in presence. And I'm going to show you as we look at the scriptures from that point forward, God is constantly wanting to be in the lives, in the presence of those created in his image. Let's take Cain and Abel, for example. Think about them. All right? Cain and Abel, here they are. They're out. You know, they're the first, you know, Genesis chapter 4 says, you know, Adam lays with his wife. She becomes pregnant, and they have a son. The first two sons are Cain and Abel. Genesis chapter 4, verse 9 says, So it came about the course of time that Cain brought an offering to the Lord from the fruit of the ground, and Abel was on his part also brought an offering from the firstborn of the flock and from the fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering, but Cain and his offering he had no regard. Now that word regard in Hebrew means to look upon. To look upon with interest and favor. So God looked at Abel's offering, and he did not look at Cain's offering. Here's the question, how'd they know? They were hanging out with the Lord. Come on now. Here they are, kicked out of the garden, and God is still hanging out with those who were created in his image. And he didn't look, and so what happens? You know, God puts great value on living with us. So he goes on and he says, So Cain became very angry and his face was gloomy. And then the Lord said to Cain, he's talking to Cain. Wow, did you know that God was wanting to talk to those people he kicked out of the garden? Absolutely he did. And why are you angry and so gloomy? And it goes on. And what happens? As he's talking to him, you know, Cain's getting angrier and angrier. And says, hey, there's sin at the door, hey, be careful, but he kills Abel anyway. But verse 9 says, then the Lord said to Cain, where's your brother Abel? And he said to him, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? And then he said, why have you done this? The voice of your brother's blood is crying out to me from the ground. Now you are cursed from the ground, which has been opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. And when you cultivate the ground, it will no longer yield its strength to you. You will be a wanderer and a drifter upon the earth. Now, what's the consequences for what Cain has done? What's the text say? We got to let the text speak to us instead of letting other stuff speak to us. Amen. Come on. What's the text say? The text says that he what worked the ground and he was getting very little crop, right? That he'd be a wanderer and a gatherer because, you know, his farming days were not going to be beneficial. What doesn't he say? Cain, you got to get out of my presence. He doesn't say that. It's not found in the text. Because notice what verse 13 says, and Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is too great to endure. Behold, you have driven me this day from the face of the earth, and I will be hidden from your face. Watch this now. Whose decision was it to get out of the presence of God? It was Cain's decision, not God's. Amen. It was Cain's decision. I'm going to go and I'm going to leave the presence of the Lord. But I love verse 15. So the Lord said to him, therefore, whoever kills Cain, vengeance will be taken on them seven times as much. And the Lord placed a mark on Cain so that no one finding him would kill him. Watch this now. Even in the midst of the mess, God was protecting Cain. How many of you are like, I hear story after story, man, I tell you what, God was protecting me in the midst of my mess. Woo, come on now. You got that testimony? There was a mark on you. Woo, come on. Why? Because you were his. He was protecting you, watching over you, knowing what he had planned for you. Verse 16, then Cain left the presence of the Lord and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. Listen to me. If you're not dwelling in the presence of God, that's not his choice, that's yours. Well, come on now. Well, God doesn't want me. That's not in the word. He wants your presence. What a powerful picture he paints. And as we go through the Old Testament, how many times do we see it over and over? We go to Noah, right? God, you know, wickedness has filled the earth, but God's like, if there's one righteous, what? And here's Noah. He finds a righteous man, and what's he do? He says, hey, I want you to build an ark. You're going to rescue human race. And we talked about a couple of weeks ago, well, the family got on. Through the family, he repopulated the whole earth. Or we think about Abraham. He calls Abraham. He speaks to Abraham. He built a covenant with Abraham. He's hanging out with Abraham. Abraham is operating in the presence. There's Isaac, Abraham's son. What happens? God shows up to him and he begins to talk to him, includes him in the covenant. And then there's Jacob. Jacob wrestles with God. Come on, man, they're having a throwdown on the plane, and what happens? Jacob's hip gets, you know, dislocated, and then he walks funny the rest of his life, right? Because he wrestled with the presence of God. God's not hiding his presence. We could talk about Moses. Oh, man, Moses. Dude's out in the water. Done messed up big time. Done murdered people. Done hiding in the wilderness for 40 years, and then a burning bush shows up, and it doesn't get consumed, and God starts talking to him out of the bush. Come on. There's many Christians who would have disqualified Moses a long time ago from being used by God. But God's like, no, 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 I'm coming. I'm coming for Moses. He says, I got a job for you. I want you to go rescue my people. And then he leads them out, right? Amen? And they get to Mount Sinai. We can fast forward through all that. They get to Mount Sinai, and I want you to notice something fascinating. Exodus chapter 19 says, so it came about on the third day. God says, I want everybody to come out to the mountain. Consecrate yourself. Get ready. When it was morning, and there was thunder and lightning flashes, and the thick cloud over the mountain, and the very loud trumpet sound, so that all the people were in the camp trembled. Okay, so God's coming down on the mountain. It's pretty scary. Thunder, lightning, his glory. All right. Verse 17, and Moses brought the people out of the camp. Watch this now. What's that next phrase? To meet God. Oh, wait a minute. God wanted to personally meet with all 2 million of them. He wanted to hang out with all 2 million of them. And they all stood at the foot of the mountain. Now, there were some instructions about not getting too close, right? Because sin has separated us partially from his presence. He said, don't let them get too close to the mountain. But he said, here's what I want you to do. I want you to bring them out. I want to talk to them. Exodus chapter 20, verse 1. Then God spoke all these words saying. Now, I'm going to pass out a piece of candy this morning for somebody to tell me what's in Exodus 20. What do you find in Exodus 20? This is the Bible quiz. Come on now. Somebody don't leave me hanging. The Ten Commandments are there. Come on. Okay, you had it on your lips. You can have candy. All right? All right, you wanted to say it. The Ten Commandments are there. Starting in the second part of verse 2, God starts talking about the Ten Commandments. Now, I want you to notice something. Where are the people? At the base of the mountain. Who's God talking to? All the people. God verbally communicated the Ten Commandments to all 2 million of them in person. You didn't learn that in Sunday school. He personally spoke to the entire crowd and said, here's the Ten Commandments. Moses had to go up later and get them on a stone, but initially, God said, I just want to talk to the people. I want to be with my people. I want to hang out with my people. I want them to be with me. Verse 18, though, and all the people were watching and hearing the thunder and lightning flashes and the sound of the trumpet and the mountain smoking. And when they saw it all, they trembled and stood at a distance. And they said to Moses, speak to us yourself and we will listen, but do not have God speak to us or we will surely die. The people are like, hey, we're not really interested in this. So Moses, here's the deal. We want you to go to the mountain. We want you to go talk to God and come back and tell us what it is that he wants. Come on, how many Christians are still living in Mount Sinai days? Pastor going up to the mountain. Spiritual elders going up to the mountain. Get a word from the Lord and come back and tell us what he wants. That's not what God wants. He wants to tell you. He wants to talk to you. He wants you to be in his presence. He wants to hang out with you. So what's God do? God's like, they're done then, right? No more presents for you. No, what's God do? He says, all right. So he gives them the instructions of the tabernacle, right? And then he gives them a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. And he says what? Hey, this is my very presence with you, dwelling with you, my very presence leading and directing and guiding you. And guess what? Then his presence rested on the tabernacle, upon the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant in the Holies of Holies. Now, not everybody could go in there, but let me tell you, every single day the presence of the Lord was there. And do you know what the instructions were for the tabernacle? If you look at one of those pictures, you'll notice. The tabernacle was to set in the very center of the camp. The camp was arranged around the tabernacle, that the presence of God would rest in the very center of life among the Israelites. God loves us to experience and be in his presence. We go on a little farther and we've got the Tabernacle of David. We'll talk more about that in a couple weeks, but Tabernacle of David, the tabernacle's gone. The Ark of the Covenant's been hanging out, and we know the story about David bringing it to Jerusalem and the mess he had, but he brought it to Jerusalem and put it in a porpoise skin tent. Not a tabernacle, just a plain old tent. Just set it in there. And he had musicians play outside. And every day, David just went into the tent and hung out with the Lord. Every day. When you read the Psalms and David talks about being in the presence of the Lord, it was in the tabernacle of David. And then Solomon comes along and they build a temple, right? And the presence of God fills the temple. And once again, we got the priest system and, you know, elaborate buildings. You know, we fast forward to 586 and the temple's destroyed. You know, the people go off for 70 years in exile. They come back. What do? They rebuild. God says, rebuild me a temple. So they rebuild the temple. His presence continues to rest in there. And then Herod, he rises to power through the Roman Empire. And what's Herod do? He wants to please the Jews, so he starts doing renovations to the temple. And what happens? Man, it becomes one of the most incredible buildings in the Roman Empire. Nothing compared to Solomon's temple, but it was monstrous. And the presence of God rested there behind the curtain. But what would happen? The people would come to the temple. The temple, if you study the temple, it was in the center of Jerusalem. All the streets in Jerusalem went to the temple because God's presence was to be the center of life. We fast forward another period. And what happens? Jesus comes. God says, once and for all, I'm going to deal with this. And so Emmanuel, God with us, came. And Jesus died on the cross. He paid the price. He redeemed that which had been lost in the garden. And here's the question I want to ask you. After Jesus died, what's the very first thing that happens? Well, there was an earthquake. Nope, that wasn't the first thing. The rocks broke open. Nope, that wasn't it. The tomb's open. Nope. Notice what it says in Matthew 27:50. And Jesus cried out again, a loud voice, and gave up his spirit, and behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom, and the earth shook, and the rocks were split. The very first thing God did once the price was paid was he split the curtain to say, my presence is now available to all of you. The fullness of my presence is all available to you. That's the very first thing he did. Why? Because he values presence. He values us being in his presence. And then what happened? when in John 14, Jesus is talking about, you know, I'm getting ready to leave. Verse 16 says, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper, so that you may be with you forever. The helper is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it does not see him or know him. But you know him, because he remains with you and will be in you. Let me tell you, what happened in the garden was awesome. But God says, I got something even greater than that. He said, here's what I'm going to do. You can come into my presence whenever, but I'm just not, you don't have to go to where I am. I'm going to come in the person of the Holy Spirit and live in you. My presence will be in you all the time. Amen. Woo, come on now. He said, that's what I want for you. I want you to be in my presence. I want you to have my presence over and over. In Matthew 28, Jesus is now getting ready to go. Final instruction. He says, what do I want you to do? I want you to what? Make disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And the last part of that, verse 20 says, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the earth. Now, I'm only with you when you're doing right. That's what it says. I'm with you in the good times. No. In the bad times. No. I'm with you through absolutely everything that's going to occur. I want you to dwell in my presence. I guarantee you there are people here, not here this morning, because they're messing up in life and they don't feel like they should come because they enter his presence. Nowhere in this book does it ever say that. Not once. Now, there's a lot of Christians who say that. But the devil wants to say that, but God never says that. In fact, in Acts chapter 1, he says, not only do I want my presence to be in you, I'm going to empower you by my presence. And you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit with what? Fire. Woo, come on now. I'm going to empower you by my presence. And then Revelation 21. I told you we were going to go from cover to cover. Revelation 21, verse 1 says, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth passed away, and there's no longer any sea. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for his husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is among the people, and he will dwell among them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be among them. What's God ultimately going to do? His presence is going to fill the whole earth. And we're going to dwell in his full presence forever. Started there, he ends there. And everywhere in between. Let me ask you a question this morning. How much do you value his presence? How much do you value being in his presence? It's just an observation. If we really believed God showed up here on Sunday mornings, we couldn't find a place for people to sit. Come on now. Amen. If we really believed his presence was here. Come on, man. We really believe that Jesus was hanging out in the place, man. But that's exactly what he says. When my people gather, I will show up in a powerful way. You say, well, I can have his presence by myself. Absolutely. He wants you to have presence day in, day out, 24/7. But listen, he says when we get together with other folk, guess what? I come because of the collective gathering of my people. My presence is greater and more weighty. And we're like, man, I just can't wait to get into the with God's people so we can encounter him. Woo, is that the goal of the church? That we're going to show up and encounter him? Or we're going to see our friends? Or we're going to hear a good message? Or we're going to sing the songs we like? No, no, no. Is my focus on, man, I just can't wait to get to him. Let me ask you it this way. When we talk about value, how much do you need his presence? Do I need his presence so much that I place a high value on it? How much do I desire his presence in my life? Man, I just can't wait to get in his presence. How emotionally attached am I to his presence? Lord, I just can't make it today without you. without your presence. Not, Lord, that I know you're there somewhere, but, oh, Lord, you're with me. I'm with you. We are together. One of the ways that this stirred in me in the last couple months is this question. What's our greatest anticipation of when we get to heaven? So I hear people talk about heaven all the time. And maybe the thing we think about first is, man, I get to see my loved ones. I get to see my husband, I get to see my kids, grandkids, you know, aunts, uncles, all those who have gone before me. Man, we can't wait to see them. We're going to hang out, and we're going to catch up, and we're going to talk, and it's going to be like old times. Or maybe it's like, man, I can't wait to get there and see that crystal sea and then that gold, those golden streets, and man, that mansion. Woo, man, he's building a mansion, baby. And I want to see what my mansion looks like and that crown. I want to see how many jewels are in my crown. You know, I want to look at those things, and man, it's going to be great. I heard somebody talking about the other day, man, I just can't wait there because the old card club's going to be together again. We're just going to play cards and fish and hang out. You know what? All those things may be true. But here's the thing we have to understand. Heaven's not a place. Heaven is a presence. See, heaven is about you and I entering into His perfect presence for all eternity. Man, I just can't wait to get there and see Jesus. To hang out with Jesus. To worship Jesus. See, that's the heart of the Father, that our cry would be. And He's like, you don't have to wait until you get there. Woo! Come on now. You can get a big down payment right now. You can have a big piece of that right now. It's not perfect. Come on, it's still living a fallen world. But man, He says, man, I want to be with you. I want to hang out with you. I want to know you. I want you to know me. I want us to do life together. I want you to be in my presence 24/7. And then one day, man, I will multiply that exponentially. But I tell you what, most of us haven't even begun to scratch the surface of what He desires for us now when it comes to His presence. God puts incredible value on your presence with How much do you value His presence? In a moment, I'm just going to pray. And I want you just to let Holy Spirit speak to your heart and your spirit. Am I really seeking after His presence? Do I really desire more of His presence in my life? Or maybe it's like, I'm not even sure really what that means. That's okay. No matter where we are in that process, God wants to begin to stir in us a desire to say, man, I want more of your presence in my life. And after I pray, we're just going to sing a song we haven't sing, but talking about how we long for His presence. And I just want to encourage you, let Holy Spirit speak to your heart today that He might begin to move us closer and closer to that which God desires for us. Amen. Well, Father, we just thank you for your word. And Lord, we pray this morning, Lord, that our cry is, Lord, we want more of your presence. And Lord, it's not you holding it back. It's, Lord, us learning to take hold of it, to embrace it, to value and desire it in our lives. And so, Holy Spirit, we just give you all the glory and the praise as you draw us near today. And we'll give you glory and praise in your mighty name. Amen.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. And I
desperate for.